So, for example, India is not only the diabetes capital, which is going to come up in some of the coming decades, and we can see it already on the slides as well. In fact, the incidence rate is also, compared to the general population, is one of the highest. In fact, in the world, we are just second to the other country is China, in fact. Is it a surprise for us? Definitely not. And in fact, as well, when we are talking about the cardiac complications, why are we talking it? Because we are also one of the cardiac disease capital as well for the world. So what is happening is, I'm sure you all are very much aware of those natural history of type 2 diabetes mellitus. What is going to happen is, once there is a diabetes onset, there is a definitive curve about the various factors, something like the insulin resistance, insulin secretion, and also the postprandial glucose. And these are the factors due to which variation, which causes the various complications. The complications which can be in the form of microvascular or the macrovascular complications as well. And as I already said it to you, India is going to be the world's diabetic capital as well. But what can we do? How can we take care of all those problems as well, which is going to come up in the future? So I think we all are very much aware about those proposed diabetic classification as well, how to diagnose the diabetes as well. My work definitely becomes much easier after the lucid and wonderful talk which was given by Dr. Ajay. So, for example, whenever a diabetic patient comes to us, so what are the things we should be trying to look out for? It should be not just FBS, PPBS. There are a lot of other just minor and also major investigations as well. If we are seeing someone on an initial visit, I would really require them or request them. These are some of the tests which we should try to be getting done, like the liver function test, the lipid profile, and also the urinary analysis as well. How are there any renal complications and other problems as well? So same way as well. So what are the other tests we should be doing? Running auto setup, okay. Yeah. So we all are physicians over here. I'm sure you all will be coming up clinical cases like this. So what happens is a middle-aged general person who comes to the emergency with worsening dyspnea on exertion past the 24 hours. And then he was already referred by a physician who had said that the patient was having already some shoulder pain. There was also some pain in the, you know, neck region as well. So the patient was already diagnosed with a myocardial infarction. And of course, he was also having a symptom of right leg claudication. And also, although the patient had already quit smoking 1 year back. So what are the things which we can start thinking of? There are a lot of things which is coming up, right? So even when the ECG was done, so it already showed a fully evolved myocardial infarction. There was already the Q wave onset as well. So there is this another clinical case as well. Let's try to think about it. So what is happening to this 55-year-old obese lady who comes to the OPD for the checkup? Once we start inquiring about her, what are the medications she is taking? Then she says, oh, I chugged off those medications and all, whatever bullshit medicines were given. I'm all doing well. However, when you try to investigate them or when you try to see further, you try to notice is like, oh my gosh, the blood pressure is 160 by 100. The HbA1c, do we need to emphasize? It's 8.2. And the fasting and the postprandial blood levels are shooting up, in fact. And when you try to do the total cholesterol, the LDL levels, the triglyceride levels as well, they are, of course, in the highest range, in fact. So how can we risk or how can we risk stratify those kind of patients? What are the problems? What is this scenario which is coming up in front of us? So by seeing all these slides, we already know definitely coronary artery disease is one of the leading cause of mortality in any of these diabetic patients, let it be the East or the West as well. In fact, even when I was there in US or even in the Western Europe as well during my training days, I must say the presentation age only tends to differ. For example, the Indian patients, I would say they tend to present a decade earlier. And the patients, especially in the West, they are slightly more older, I would say, age-wise. However, now coming to the other geographical and epidemiological data as well, in fact, the diabetes patients who are having those heart problems, definitely their proportion is increasing. And even in future as well, the number is supposed to go higher and higher. So definitely there is a big, big role for all the physicians who are going to see them, review them, and of course do the follow-up as well. So what is happening is coronary artery disease risk is definitely up to 3 to 4 times higher in those people who are having a diabetes. In fact, when we are trying to talk about things like sudden cardiac death, it's up to 50% times higher in males, and in women, in fact, it's 100% higher. So what is happening is, especially in the females, as we all know, later ages, after, especially in the postmenopausal age, there is no benefit of the hormone which is normally present with them. And in fact, in these diabetic patients, when we try to do angiography, when we are trying to look in their blood vessels as well, the diffused lesions, which are difficult to treat, the triple vessel disease as well, they are very, very common. And in fact, even those coronary arteries as well, most of the times, they tend to affect those distal lesions, in fact, which are associated with not only atypical onset, but what is called a silent myocardial infarction as well. Silent myocardial infarction is more common in the diabetes, in fact. And of course, let's not forget what is called as the LV dysfunction. So what is the difference which is there between the diabetic and the non-diabetic? We always are concerned about the mortality and the morbidity as well. So the diabetics are most of the times commonly associated with diabetic cardiomyopathy as well. And in fact, when you're trying to treat those patients as well, even if you're trying to put up a stent, or even if you're trying to do a bypass surgery as well, when the damage has already been done, the outcomes are less favorable for those. In fact, the restenosis rate for these procedures are still much more common. In fact, and the basic mechanism, what is associated with this is due to the defective lipid metabolism, and I'm also going to show some more things as well. So this is the phenomenon of atherosclerosis, which doesn't spare any of the blood vessels. Let it be in the carotids, let it be in the coronaries, let it be the peripheral vasculature, or any of these vessels. So these are the ones which tends to cause not only stroke, the heart attack, angina, but also the intermittent claudication as well. So whatever happens in medicine, there is a logic behind it. There, we must be able to question it. Why, how, what, when, where, like this. So even this as well, there are a lot of pathogenesis which is involved, secondary to all these pathology, whichever we are seeing. So the pathology, of course, tends to manifest in its own peculiar ways as well, with the classical symptoms of angina can be there, unstable angina, or even myocardial infarction. Otherwise, as I already said, sometimes those patients can also be having a silent myocardial infarction. And when we are talking about this, so I must say those other two group of patients as well, which may have myocardial infarction in a silent way, what is called as those elderly people and also the women, in fact, because this is something really a very important topic also for everyone, in fact. So as I already said, atypical symptoms as well. So when such patient comes to us, how can we evaluate them? Can we do something for those people? Of course, one of the easiest test to screen them is an ECG on a resting basis, but it has its own low sensitivity. So how can we make them better? So we can, of course, try to do a combination of clinical features, try to do serial cardiac enzymes, and also try to see how are those symptoms also getting relieved as well. And of course, you should not just leave it at the ECG. You should try to also do a echocardiography as well. And you can also further evaluate them with a stress ECG, stress echocardiography, or even angiography or nuclear imaging as well. And as we were talking about those cardiac problems which these patients or these people tend to have, of course, hypertension is one of the most common associations. Up to so much that up to 20 to 60% of those diabetics tend to have this comorbidity, in fact. And the problem is, single entity, in fact, it tends to increase the risk of not only microvascular complications, but also the macrovascular complications as well. And the mortality tends to increase by not 4 or 5 times, 7 times increase. And in fact, if someone tends to develop a diabetic nephropathy, the mortality is 37 folds higher.
and it has already been shown as well, 85% of those nephropathy patients will be having hypertension. Why I'm trying to coming to especially about those dyslipidemia in these patients. So there is a big role of the environmental factors, inherited factors, and also the biological factors as well, which tends to play a role for the dyslipidemia in such kind of people. So these are the ones which tend to increase the triglycerides and decrease the HDL cholesterol level, and also increase the triglycerides and small dense lipoprotein levels as well. And this is such a specialty, that's why they have been given a special name for this. Special name is atherogenic dyslipidemia. So this is a classical case. So normally in 21st century, we all talk about the, you know, the equality of sexes, but the nature has been a little bit harsh, not only the mortality, but also the morbidity and also the complications which is associated with the disease is different. So what is happening, for example, in a typical UK population, if there's a man who is diagnosed with diabetes at the age of 45, he has a chances of nearly 12% death in the next 15 years. In the next 15 years means when he's going to celebrate his 60th birthday. Similarly, the life expectancy of 17.1 years is much lower than compared to the non-diabetics. However, when we try to compare it for the females, we can see it over here is the lady will be having a 9% risk. So it is slightly lower, okay, for compared to those other people for the next 15 years when she will be celebrating her 60th birthday. However, the life expectancy is going to be almost two decades lesser when they try to compare the diabetics versus the non-diabetics. So a common question comes into our mind. Okay, we are aware of the premature cardiovascular disease as well, but can we try to take care of this? What are those additional risk factors as well? So if you really want to take care of those additional risk factors, of course, you should be taking care of the overweightness and also try to make sure the patient is having a good hypertensive, what is called as a normotensive, I would say. So less than 140 by 80 millimeter, although when the patient is not taking any medication. Similarly, the patient should not be having any microalbuminuria. Of course, the patient should become a non-smoker. And again, same thing, it doesn't have a high-risk lipid profile, and there is no history of cardiovascular disease as well. And of course, without any family history as well. We all are very much aware that about the role of the glycemic control, especially for the coronary artery disease. There are a lot of trials as well, which has already happened, which we can already see. So what is going to happen is, so these are some of those interesting forest plots. I'm so sorry. This works, but not so good. So this is an interesting forest plot in the sense there was a systematic review and meta-analysis in which they tried to pull up the data of almost 18 clinical trials, and they tried to see for the cardiovascular disease among the patients who were having impaired fasting glucose or non-impaired. And then that's what they saw, that of course there is higher mortality with the ones with impaired glucose levels. Metabolic syndrome is becoming more common, not just in US, even in India as well. This is another malnutrition thing which is becoming really, really common, in fact. So even for them, when they try to see for the risk of coronary heart disease, it is pretty much higher in those patients who are having diabetes. Similarly, the risk of death as well for such patients is much more higher. So this is an interesting slide in the sense, what about the mechanism, what is happening, how do the mechanism which leads to the coronary heart disease? So there is a pentad. So what is the pentad of inflammation, hyperglycemia, insulin resistance, dyslipidemia, and of course the thrombosis as well. These are the ones which combined together tend to cause subclinical atherosclerosis. And these are the ones when start aggravating with time, with passage of time, they all will be coming up with the clinical features. So the risk of myocardial infarction as well is much higher for those patients having the diabetes. That's what is being shown by the red block. I'm so sorry for this. So this is a small, there are a lot of small things to be read. So this was again another interesting data, but a prospective observational study.
Prospective studies are like the one of the really important benchmarks whenever a clinical trial is being conducted.
So when they tried to see, what was seen was, these lights are not so good.
So what is happening is the diabetics who had already a myocardial infarction, they have the highest CHD risk, in fact.
And when they again try to see for the cardiovascular CVD mortality or total mortality as well, of course, it is the highest for metabolic syndrome. And the next was, of course, diabetes, in fact. So similarly, and this is another interesting forest plot, a very compact. So what it tries to show is when they try to compare the diabetes mellitus, especially for the adverse cardiovascular events as well, it tends to increase the risk of these cardiac adverse effects, right? So this is another pictorial demonstration which is showing the patients who are having the diabetes tend to have an increased cardiovascular risk. You know, they say it like this, the data tends to speak for itself. And that's why I was trying to use a lot of these graphical presentations, in fact. Then again, using the data from the East-West study, the diabetes mellitus patients tend to have a higher risk of death, in fact. And also the life expectancy for such patients is much lesser. Similarly, in this is again another slide as well, which is showing about the diabetic control. So I would like to emphasize over here, because what happens is, a lot of times the common thinking is if you are trying to do an intensive, very strict control for the glucose levels, are those patients going to get the benefit? So there are a lot of good studies as well which showed it like this. If you are trying to do an intensive control, yes, they might benefit in fact. However, if we are trying to do a too much strict control, especially of a person or patient who is admitted in the CCU, it should not be advised because they are not associated with good or better cardiovascular outcomes, in fact. So similarly, in this study as well, so what had happened, they were trying to see what is the effect of the HbA1c values, especially for the risk of the cardiovascular disease. So what is happening is if someone is having a higher HbA1c levels, those patients have a higher risk as well. Similarly, the same thing. And then in this as well, a lot of times we start to think that, is it really good if we try to use a single molecule? Is it really good enough to achieve a good diabetic control as well? So a lot of times, especially with progression of time, I'm talking like in several years with time, like 3 years, 6 years, and 9 years, as we can see it over here, the glycemic control over a diabetic monotherapy tends to worsen, in fact. So what it means is with passage of time, we should keep on watching those patients again and again during the follow-up, and we should be open to add some other additives as well for such patients. So this is again another slide which was taken from the NEJM paper, which came in 2008 by Hallman. So it showed again was the intensive glycemic control in those diabetic patients tends to reduce the long-term myocardial infarction rate for such people as well. So on an overall basis, what we can see as well, advanced trial was another major study as well, which again showed with better rates, we can decrease the complication rate as well. This was a very important paper, like of a patient. So I had already taken the consent. So she is from a very reputed institute. She was admitted, treated, and all everything. She came with a tachycardia. I did the ablation as well. And after that, everything was fine. So she was having a tachycardia. So we did the ablation, everything. And then after that, she was doing well. But when I was trying to look at the ejection fraction as well, still it was not improving. So if we look carefully, the ejection fraction, it is 25%. 18-year-old girl. So what was the other reasons as well? So then I was trying to go through the other tests as well. And I was pretty surprised. No one had done the IBS. So she was having she was also a diabetic, in fact. And later on, in the coming weeks, when we tried to take good care of the sugar levels and all, she developed really much, much better. So this is the 2D echo of that same girl. So as we can see it over here, the pumping action has improved. quite a lot significantly. So what I mean to say is there are other problems as well, which cannot just be seen by those ECGs, which is not seen by the conventional imaging modalities as well. So we need to be a little bit more watchful. So there's no better role for all those people, in fact, who are much more watchful for their patients. So when we are trying to take care of those complications or the problems, if we are trying to treat them as well, so of course, we should, for example, for the hypertension and all, we all are very much aware how we should be taking care of, especially using the ACE inhibitors or ARBs, in fact. And of course, always try to stress for the therapeutic lifestyle, in fact. Similarly, for the dyslipidemia as well, start with the statin therapy. And then antiplatelet therapy is coming certainly in doubt. Because at the recently, in the last European Society of Cardiology meeting, which had happened just a few months back, when they were trying to use only aspirin for the primary prevention, it was in fact increasing the risk of complications. So we should be a little bit more careful when we are trying to use aspirin only for the primary prevention for our patient. So to conclude my slides, diabetes is definitely increased with higher cardiovascular mortality, and intensive glycemic control in diabetics is definitely beneficial, especially when we try to consider the cardiovascular problems. However, when we are trying to overall approach the cardiovascular problems, there's a need for a multifactorial approach. Thank you so much for your kind attention. I'll be happy to answer any questions.